Welcome to Screw the Commute, the entrepreneurial podcast dedicated to getting you out of the car and into the money with your host, lifelong entrepreneur and multimillionaire, Tom Antion.
Hey, everybody, it's Tom here with episode 258 of Screw the Commute podcast. We've got a repeat guest because she is just a great and interesting story. Her name is Jan McInnis, and we'll bring her on in a moment. I hope you didn't miss episode 257, Heidi Richards Mooney. She built a lifestyle business around flowers, and she runs a women's movement, too. Now, I am looking for an accountant that's veteran-friendly. I'm reaching out to everybody to find a veteran-friendly accountant so that we can get an audit done. It has to be a CPA that does actual audits that will give me a good deal to do an audit on our school so we can take the GI Bill. So putting that out to everybody. Grab a copy of our automation ebook at screwthecommute.com/automatefree, where you'll get an ebook that has saved me millions and millions of keystrokes and helped me handle 40,000 customers and 150,000 subscribers without pulling my hair out. It's yours free for listening to Screw the Commute. You find it at screwthecommute.com/automatefree. And while you're at it, grab a copy of our podcast app. It's screwthecommute.com/app. And we have complete video and screen capture instructions so you're not lost in figuring out how to use all the fancy functions. Grab that at screwthecommute.com/app. Now, our sponsor is the Internet Marketing Training Center of Virginia. It's a distance learning school, but we are coming up with in-house classes this summer because of the GI Bill. So you can either come in class if you are in the Virginia Beach area, or you can study from anywhere in the world through our, you know, well-established distance learning portal. And you can check that out at imtcva.org, imtcva.org. And also, I'll tell you a little bit later about a quiz we have there to show you how traditional colleges and universities are ripping off families and students. So I'll tell you about that later. All right, let's bring on the main event. Jan McInnis is here. She's a comedian, a keynote speaker, a comedy writer, an author. And for over 26 years, she's toured the country making people laugh and showing people how to use humor in business. And she's also an established comedy writer who's sold material to everyone from Jay Leno to guests on the Jerry Springer Show. I didn't know that they had their own writers. But so, Jan, are you ready to screw the commute?
Tom, I got nothing else to do these days in quarantine. Let's do it.
That's what I'm saying. Folks, if you're listening this later, this was recorded on a big, right in the middle of the coronavirus thing. And so a lot of events are getting canceled and so forth. So Jan has more time to talk to me today. So she took the time to be back on the call. But anyway, tell everybody what you're doing now, not just sitting around the house, but what you're doing now, and then we'll take you back, see how you came up through the ranks.
What am I doing now as far as keynote speaking?
Yeah, all those things that you're doing to help people in the speaking business.
I started as a comedian and then moved into the corporate comedy, and now do keynotes for businesses. And I go around the country showing people how to use humor in business. It's not about telling jokes. I say, you know, my friends are like, oh, you're just going to tell people how to write jokes and be a comedian. No. That's about an 8-year course.
Right.
It's not pretty. No, I tell business how to use humor to diffuse tension, you know, kick off tough conversations, handle tough coworkers and colleagues, that sort of thing. So it's a business skill, and people are learning it's a business skill, and I'm getting booked a lot.
Well, how have you changed that over time, because everybody's so politically correct nowadays?
As far as
what you teach people, you changed it significantly? Because you know, you can say one wrong word and people will like stab you.
Well, you know, I do tell people use your common sense. I mean, sex, drugs, rock and roll, politics,
right?
Stay away from. But
religion, probably too.
Religion is a good one. Yeah, you know, but use your common sense. I have a couple of rules, like don't say something to someone you wouldn't say to their face. Don't do the easy jokes. Mm-hmm. You know, I was one time I was doing a event, emceeing an event, and 4,400 people, and they ran out of dinner for 1,500 people.
Oh, geez.
Yeah, and it was their employee appreciation banquet. People were mad. And I went on stage, and I could have done the easy, you know, pull the curtain back. Hey, I found them. But it would have killed. I had a lot of jokes. But there was a meeting planner backstage crying because she was about to lose her job. And so, you know, watch the easy humor, the stuff that you think is funny, and the obvious stuff. You know, I spoke to a couple hundred blind merchants, and I'm a comedian. I want to get on stage. You go, hey, I'm naked. Don't do that either.
Right.
Not because it's a bad visual, but also it's, you know, they've heard these jokes. They've heard all the stuff that the easy jokes, the blind jokes. They even had in my contract, no blind jokes.
Yeah.
We have heard everything.
Right.
So, you know, you just got to watch that. And then I tell people where to look for humor. People are always like, oh, I'm not funny. I'm not naturally funny. Comedians, we, you know, most of us just know where we've done it so long, we know where to look. So that's what I tell businesses.
Yeah, and it's and some people think they're funny, and they're not. I mean, this is a skill. This is an actual skill you need to study and hone. And I'm not saying to the level that you're at, but you can't just say, oh, everybody laughs at me in the
break room
and I don't need you. Yeah.
And it's a muscle. It's like you got to practice it. You can't just decide one day. Even comedians, I mean, now doing this, you know, 20 plus years, I know where to look, and it's sort of automatic when I walk into a room. So if you want to use some humor, first of all, don't shy away. Don't wait for someone to give you permission. Start trying to practice it a little bit and looking around and the different places you can find humor and practice it. And when you really need to use it, when it is a tense situation and you need to, you know, kick off a tense discussion or something, you want to use a little bit of humor, you'll be able to do it because you'll have already practiced and know where to look.
Yeah. And there's so many benefits of it. I mean, people like you better. It's, you know, it's better in negotiations and,
oh yeah. And, it makes you approachable. You know, don't you want to talk to somebody who's been sort of joking around a little bit and feels a little open?
Right. Now, so you've been doing this 26 years, and people are going to say, well, Jan, you had it so easy coming up through the ranks as a female comedian.
Yeah. Woo, no. Yeah. I started before social media, for crying out loud. I mean, we had VHS tapes, Tom. Mailed out a packet day.
But it was especially easy for a girl because you stood out. You're unique, right? It was especially easy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Good and bad. You know what? If I did well, I had more than one occasion people come up to me and say, we need to apologize. When we saw a woman on the stage, we all looked at each other and said, this is going to stink. And you were great. But if I do badly, I'm like bombing for every woman comedian on the planet, you know, everyone. But and it's a little harder. They wouldn't put two women comedians on a show together because then they had to call it a women's show. I got one of the nicest compliments years ago. I was working the Comedy Castle in Detroit, and Kathleen Madigan, very funny.
I like her.
I saw Mark Ridley, the nicest guy in comedy, and don't everyone call him now, but he's a great guy. I saw that I was on the show with Kathleen, and I thought, oh God, they're going to cancel me. She's the headliner, I'm the feature, and he's going to find out that he's got two women on there, and I need the money. And so I was very nervous, and got to show week, and I wasn't canceled. And we went on and did the show, and afterwards I was talking to him, and I said, Mark, thank you. You know, I really need the money. Why'd you keep us? And he said, both of you are funny. You're not women comics. You're funny comics.
Oh, that's
it was a
nice,
great show, and I knew it'd be a good show, and it was. So.
Hey, was Ricky Gervais, was he a stand-up at all?
You know, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, because I was just loving this comment he made. I think it was Oscars or something, where he says he's getting in the face of all the actors and actresses, and he says if ISIS had a streaming service, you'd call your agent. So I thought he might have been a stand-up at one time, but
You know, but I use a lot of stand-up comedians at these awards things because we're good at one take. You know, actors and actresses, not, I mean, they get 50 takes.
Exactly.
And,
right.
You know, we get one and know that.
I did one thing in a TV commercial. It was 263 takes. How do you like that? You know?
Whoa.
So I don't know.
I can make any mistakes I want here because you can just,
right.
You know how to edit.
Edit out. Yeah. So it was easy coming up through as a female, right?
And very hard. Yeah. Harder. I'd say a harder, just to get, you know, if it came up to me or another guy comic, especially for a corporate event or something, that I would lose to the guy comic.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, one time I picked up a string of shows, and the only reason I did was they called me, and the client agent called me and said, are you available this one date? They've got a bunch of shows, but they only want you this first date. And I said, sure, I can do that date. And it was for a big kind of male dominated corporation. And I did the show and it rocked. And afterwards they canceled the other comic and used me. And they said, you are our second choice, but because you're a woman, we're afraid to use you. That comic wasn't available for the first show. You were. I came in, rocked, it went well. And that's why I got the show. But they said, we wanted you, but we're afraid. And women had a reputation at the time, I'm not sure now, but for being a dirtier, which
mm-hmm.
I don't think that's valid. I know many funny women who are not dirty, so but they got some sort of a rap years ago anyway when I was doing it.
So did you do a lot of those free open mic nights to get started, or how did you do?
Yeah, I did. You know what? I did open mic. The first one I did was back in the 80s during the boom, you know. I mean, Matt, MCs in comedy clubs were making six figures. It was crazy. I was so freaked out by the lights and everything. I didn't go back for 8 years. I missed the comedy boom. Yeah, I went in. Then I thought it just wouldn't go away. And about 8 years later, I thought, I got to try this again. So I went back. Comedy Cafe, Washington, D.C., great club. Had a comedy club on the top, a sports bar in the middle, and a strip club down
right.
Basement. Yeah, I could never figure out where the comics went in between shows. Years until I figured that out. But I went up at an open mic there, and I practiced before the open mic because I practiced with a light in my eye because I had been so freaked out 8 years earlier. And I went up and had, you know, my 5 minutes and did 3 minutes and couldn't remember the rest, but it was killing. And so I remember just thinking in my head, stop, they're laughing, you can't remember it, just stop.
Mm-hmm.
I got off stage, was sitting there doing that little seesaw thing, thinking, you know, I want to do this again. Nope, that was it. You're a marketing person, you're not doing this. And all of a sudden I get this tap on my shoulder, and it was the MC, and he said, call Pat tomorrow. I said, who's Pat? He goes, she books this place, she caught your act, she wants to give you work. And that was it.
Wow.
I was off. Yeah.
Wow, good for you. Good for you.
Kept my day job. Yeah, I kept a day job for a couple of years and then finally just took the plunge.
Yeah, so that's what I was going to get to. So you actually, those 8 years, you had to do something to make a living, right? So what, even before that, the first time you tried, what was that, what were you thinking when you said, oh, you know, I think I want to be a comic? You were in some job, right?
Yeah, I was a marketing person, which actually helped me. My marketing was better than my act for the first year. I say if you're trying for something, learn as much as you can if you're not where you want to be. And I did. I learned marketing and I worked hard at it. I was very good. I was in the marketing in Washington, D.C. And I have to say there was one other little start and stop in there. In that 8 years, there was a Jay Leno comedy challenge across the country. And they had said they were doing contests at various comedy clubs around the country. And I had not done comedy in a few years, but I thought, well, let me throw my hat in the ring on this. And you had to send in a audio tape or video. You had to send it a tape. I didn't know you had to send in a video. I'm stupid, you know. I was doing my marketing job. You had to have it postmarked the day after Thanksgiving, that Friday. And I thought, well, I have a few jokes from my, you know, comedy try 4 years earlier. So I thought, well, my family's funny. I'll just follow them at Thanksgiving, write some jokes, and then I will record them. I borrowed my dad's mini cassette recorder.
Yeah, right.
I'm not kidding. And I walked around. So nothing funny happened at Thanksgiving, right? Nothing. So the next day I thought, well, what am I? The morning I woke up and thought, well, I don't have any jokes. I'm not going to send this in. I only have a couple from my last set. All of a sudden, these alarm clocks that I'd never used in my life went off and woke me straight out of bed. I thought, okay, I'm awake. So I literally, Tom, I wrote some jokes. I walked around my condo recording them in this recorder, and I mailed it in, and I got a call the next week, and they said, your jokes were funny. How many people entered this thing? And it turned out they had three comedy contests going on, DC, Maryland, Virginia. I was in Virginia, and they said, we want to book you for this contest. There's eight comedians. And I thought, okay, they had hundreds of people. I got one of the slots, and I remember watching the Maryland contest, and I was on two nights later, and Art Campbell, remember him?
Yeah.
Arch Campbell. He from Virginia, Maryland, DC area. He was on the news talking about it. He goes, all the professional comedians are vying for a spot on the Tonight Show. And I jumped straight out of bed and said, professional? I had never done stand-up comedy except for that one time. And I went into the contest that night. I was so naive. We drew numbers. And I didn't know you draw numbers. So they said, we're going to figure out who goes first, second. I said, well, I'll go fourth. Everyone looked at me like, are you an idiot? We draw numbers. You know? So, I just totally embarrassed myself, but I did well in the contest and I didn't win, obviously, but I got a mention in the newspaper the next day.
Wow.
And my friend walked in the office and goes, were you in a contest? And nobody saw the newspaper because my mom bought every issue.
Right.
So long story short, it was a starts and stops and it was not a straight shot to stand up or keynote speaking.
Wow. So, and this is over a period of how many years?
I think that was about 8 years until I finally got that open mic and they booked me. And then I kept my day job for about 2 years, 2.5 years. I had my eye, I really knew I wanted to leave, but I still had to make a living. And I worked on the East Coast, up and down the East Coast, for a couple of years, just about every night and weekend, and, did my day job. And that was exhausting.
Well, why do you,
I was younger.
Why'd you keep your day job if you were making $10,000 a show?
I think I was. There was a pass the hat show. I think I made $1.29. It was,
the hat was worth more than the amount of money that you got.
I'm surprised the hat came back. Yeah. One of the best advice I got in comedy, a comedian, Lord Corrett, said, "Stay at the bottom as long as you can, Jan. MC, because you will build your act. If you try to push to get, and this is good business mm-hmm. advice for anyone." If you try to push to get to the feature spot, which is 30 minutes, you will end up being a mediocre feature. And there are millions of mediocre features. Mm. What you do is stay at the bottom, put together a very strong 30 minutes. So when you get to feature, you fly through that, blast through it up to the headline spot. And that's what I did. And it worked great. But I stayed as a feature for a lot longer. And I stayed, did open mics, and I did everything to build myself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it should be easy to stay at the bottom, right? A lot of people that they decide to make a career of that.
Yeah. Well, I know a lot of people who spend a lot of time preparing and never leave. And that's mm-hmm. that's a mistake too. I mean, another woman that started with me, she took every class you could take, and she, prepared, and she got some good gigs here and there. She never left. And years later, she kind of faded away. And years later, I had ran into her in Minnesota and we had drinks, and I looked at her, and after a couple of drinks, I said, why didn't you do this? We talked about being full-time comedians. Why didn't you do it? Without missing a beat, she looked at me and she goes, because I saw what happened to you. She saw the bar gigs and the hard gigs and really terrible nights. Mm-hmm. And she scared her and got out.
Yeah.
So don't let that stuff scare you off either.
So tell us more, a little bit about the business of this. So do you have an agent or a booking person?
I have an assistant who works part-time with mm-hmm. me, Brenda. And I don't work exclusively with anyone. I do work through some bureaus, some agents. I do some on my own. You have to kind of be a jack of all trades of everything, Tom. Mm-hmm. You gotta, as internet, everything from doing some Google ads to Fiverr. I know that's one of your tips, to use people on Fiverr. I do a lot of marketing, a lot of marketing on my own.
I think that's where the comedy clubs were getting some of their comics.
What?
That's why they went under from Fiverr.
maybe some of the comics getting some of their jokes from Fiverr. It's you just got to do everything, and it's what's the hard thing, and you've mentioned this, is to not you don't know what rabbit hole to go down, and that's sometimes you think, oh, that's a great idea and this guy's making millions, but you have to figure out how, if that's going to work for you, spend a little time looking at it, but some things can just suck up your time.
Now you've got a book out, right?
I've got a couple books. I wrote one on, because I write, since I've written for freelance for everyone on the planet, I put a book together. People kept asking me, how do you write so fast? So my book, Finding the Funny Fast, How to Create Quick Humor to Connect with Clients, Coworkers, and Crowds. And it's some tips on how to use humor, how to find humor. Easy. It's short. It's a small book because, you know, I'm talking about writing humor fast.
Fast, right?
Right. No, I'll give you a 50 million book. And the other book is Convention Comedian, Stories and Wisdom from Two Decades of Chicken Dinners and Comedy Clubs. Yum.
So I'll bet you're going to be doing more online now because...
I'm doing a lot of writing. I picked up some big writing gigs, which is nice. I'm enjoying that. I'm trying to parlay that into, that was one of my questions for you, how to get, you know, parlay some writing gigs into other things, because I'm getting more writing hits than anything else right now.
Yeah. Well, that's good though, because like I said, you know, I'm sure you and lots of people at this time in the world are getting canceled because a lot of meetings are getting canceled.
Yeah, people are getting a little, I had an event this past weekend that went fine, but I'm supposed to be in Cabo right now. This does not sound like Cabo.
No.
No. big event canceled. So, yeah. So good things at home, trying to find other avenues. I would say as an entrepreneur, you need to find, have a couple different irons in the fire. Don't just stick all your eggs in one basket. You know, what other skills do you have? What other things can you do? You know, I'm touring theaters with a baby boomer comedy show. I do keynotes. I do comedy. I do master of ceremonies. Which I've gotten a lot of calls for that as well. I do writing, you know, just a lot of different things. So when one thing isn't popping, something else is.
Yeah. And it's good that you have the writing because you don't have to go anywhere for that. Right. It's not like you're in a sitcom, you know, meeting room with five other writers. Right.
Right. Right. So yeah, that's been helpful. So yeah. Well, we'll all weather through it.
Yeah. Now this thing about writing for guests on Jerry Springer. Now, tell me more about that. Who contacts you for that?
I still do actually a little writing for radio prep service. You know, if you're a radio station DJ, you come in the morning at 4 a.m. and you need some stories and you need some jokes and you need. So I write for. One of those prep services that goes out to, you know, hundreds or thousands of radio stations, and they get clients occasionally. That's why I can't say who it was.
Right.
They get clients occasionally, and they say, hey, we need some writers for this. And so I did. And it was so funny because I wrote these jokes. They were, I had to write like a guy wearing a real flashy outfit. He was a pimp, I think. And he was wearing a real flashy outfit, you know, shocker on Jerry's. Yeah. And, you know, jokes like, you know, I didn't know Pepto-Bismol made, you know, clothing, you know, one-liners like that to debate this other guy. But that same night I wrote jokes for the Springer guest that morning. That night I was doing a show for doctors. That's two different levels of writing.
Really, right. Yeah. There, you know? Right. So, hey, you got Mari still going out there. Mari Povich, he still has crazy guests. There's another one.
Oh, is he? Okay, good. Yeah. Yeah, some of it is staged. Some of it is, some of it really is the baby daddy, but some of it is staged. They have little, you know, arguments and fights and debate and that sort of thing. Tom, just to save you some time if you're watching it.
Right, exactly. So, where do they find these books?
Amazon, or you can go to my website. I have book links on my website.
Give it to them. And we'll put it in the show notes too.
TheWorkLady.com.
The Work Lady.
Yeah, not The Working Girl.
I was
going to
say that's exactly what I was thinking.
I have been introduced as The Working Girl. And, you know, I did The Work Lady because I do a lot of office humor and nobody can spell McInnis.
Yeah, okay.
So as opposed to trying to get every variation of misspelling of McInnis, I went with, tried something else. So TheWorkLady.com.
TheWorkLady.com. Okay, so... All right. Well, thanks so much for coming on and give us an update. Can't wait to. I'll turn the radio on. The darn thing is, they don't give you credit. You know, this joke was from Jan McInnis.
No, they don't. But it's fun driving around the country, or you know, and hearing somebody do a joke. Go, oh, I wrote that. A friend of mine actually read a top 10 list to me once. That a DJ had said, I said, stop right there. I got it on my computer. I wrote that. Okay.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. And so these are distributed to DJs around the world. So the same joke could be told on 100 different stations.
Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. All right. Well, thanks so much for coming on. We, The Work Lady, whenever you need have a real meeting now where people actually are not afraid to come to. This would be a great person to have had to jazz
it up. I'll bring my own mic.
Well, you know, start doing Zoom meetings. Do Zoom comedy for people.
Yeah.
So they're meeting remotely. There you go.
I had somebody actually once ask if I would do that. I said, I will try anything. This was years ago, and they didn't end up doing it. But I was like, let's do it. Let's try a Skype comedy.
Yeah. You know? Well,
if I can hear them, I think it might work.
Well, what's interesting is, you know, one of the rules of comedy, you want to be as close as you can to the audience. So like 3,000 miles is a little bit of a gap to cover, but... But
I'll put my cat and my dog in some chairs in front of me.
If anybody can do it, you can do it. So,
yeah. So
thanks so much for coming on and catching us up.
Thanks a lot, Tom. Take care.
All right. We'll catch everybody on the next episode. See you later.